Hello, multi-membership fans. Yeah, and thank you to Murdo MacDonald up in the Highlands of Scotland for that timely malt mention. Murdo actually asked me to hold back that malt mention from a few years ago until I reviewed a Scotch Malt Whisky Society bottling, which I'm doing now in Whisky Review 490. Whisky Review 480. Bear with me, because I've not done a Scotch Malt Whisky Society review before. Now, I've mentioned it when I gave a presentation several years ago at the Victoria Whisky Festival in British Columbia in Canada, and I gave a presentation talking a wee bit about, some of the bottlings, included some of the bottlings, and they were good bottlings. But I'm going to kind of introduce the Scotch Malt Whisky Society for you. Brief history, brief resume, some interesting little pointers just to help you on your way, and then I will review the contents of this bottle, which are rather hard to find now, but they're still out there. There's bottles of this still out there, and it's a very interesting experience, actually. This is, of course, a single malt whisky from Scotland. Here's the bottle. The label says Society Single Cask number 127.5. And for the seriously anorak Scotch Malt Whisky Society fans, you'll know that means Port Charlotte. Fifth cask of Port Charlotte. And they describe it as morning dew on Isla. I have smelt it. I have tasted it. I have never experienced morning dew on Isla anything like this. Morning dew at Chernobyl? Yes, I could go along with that, but not in Isla. I wait to hear this. Thank goodness I've got the steampunk to filter out the dazzling dialogue here coming off this. It's one of only 243 bottles. Yeah, whatever. The fresh nose brings marum, grass, bonfires and sea breezes. Water releases shellfish, vanilla cream and chilli. The neat palate is sweet and peppery with tobacco smoke, dark chocolate and starfruit, changing to seafood with cream, onions, salt and pepper. Oh, how savoury. Just the sort of stuff I put on my fish and chips. It is, in fact, Port Charlotte. Heavily peated single malt whisky from Brookladdy Distillery. And it's actually hugely phenolic and very nice indeed. Oh my goodness, what a grenade. I'm going to add some water to this, and while it's settling down, I'm going to tell you about the Scotch Malt Whisky Society, which was originally founded back in the 70s, 80s, at a time when nobody was particularly interested in single malts, by a group of friends, larger-than-life characters, who would meet basically at friends' house, talk about whisky, and then they'd put their money into the pot, and because some of them were quite well off, they'd phone up a distillery and say, "Excuse me, we'd like to buy a little cask of your whisky and bottle it for ourselves." And the distillers, of course, because there was not a lot of demand for single malt whisky, and because, like any businessman, they're looking for cash in the till, well, they agreed and sold these group of friends some single casks of whisky. And as usual, it started with one cask, and then there was two casks, and then there was three casks. And then people got to know about it and said, "Here, can I buy a bottle? Because, you know, that's brilliant whisky, that, and that's fantastic whisky, because it's straight from the cask, it's simply barrier filtered, it's not got caramel in it, it's not watered down to 40%. In other words, it's absolutely full of rocket fuel. That kind of Scotch whisky." And amongst traditional Scottish people, particularly the haggis bashers and the Monroe chasers, that is a very popular way to have your Scotch single malt. So one thing led to another, and they got themselves organised and became a little bit more businesslike, and they founded the Scotch Malt Whisky Society meeting in the vaults in Leith, in Edinburgh. And later on, as they got even more organised and sold it off to Glenmorangie, as I think it was Glenmorangie, latterly LVMH, who have basically, you may as well say Diageo, who have a controlling stake in LVMH. So owned by the same people who own Glenmorangie and Ardbeg. And the interesting thing, well, I joined for a year when it became, basically it became a fancy independent bottler. That's what the Scotch Malt Whisky Society is. They continue to bottle single casks at cask strength, unchill filtered, and their little moniker, their little gambit, their little marketing spin is that they don't name the distilleries, they simply apply them a number. They don't tell you which number they relates to which distillery, but within 2 minutes you can pick it up in a search engine and print it off on the internet, which everybody does. Right, so Scotch Malt Whisky Society got organised. They set up their website, smws.co.uk. Yep, I knew I'd get it right. And they got themselves distinctive green bottles, which this is the current version. They used to be kind of more rounded at the neck. I joined for a year. It cost me £60 for membership. But you can tell malt mates that was a few years ago. I just remember for one year because, well, I bought a ticket for one of the tasting events that they organise. Now, I'm not wanting to kind of put them down about this, but it was an Irish whisky tasting at the Bagpiping Centre in Glasgow on St Patrick's Day. Now, I ask you, would that sell tickets? And they cancelled it through lack of interest. Anyway, moving on. So I thought to myself, well, what am I paying a subscription for? They've got a little magazine called Unchill Filtered now. I'm sure it's kind of nice and friendly and appropriate and all the rest of it. And they've got some nice venues and they offer meals and they've got a little bar and a little quiet reading room up in the centre of Edinburgh and also in London. And they continue to use the vaults down in Leith for nice venue for different functions and all the rest of it. And I was there actually a few years ago with Malt Maniacs at the time when I was a member. And it was good company. And in fact, it was Charlie McLean kind of hosted the evening. And the man is a professional. He's really, really good. In fact, Charlie does whisky tours around Scotland. And I think the ticket price is well worth it. He is such a knowledgeable person. And it's fascinating when he's going around distilleries, he just takes wee notes and notebooks, all just to keep himself up to date with all the information. Brilliant. Back to Scotch Malt Whisky Society bottlings. So increasingly run on a commercial basis. Some of the bottlings do not impress me at all. However, other bottlings do. And recently there was a bottling of Glenmorangie, which is extremely rare to find in independent bottlers, Glenmorangie. But of course, the same company that owned Glenmorangie owned Scotch Malt Whisky Society. It was a 13-year-old Glenmorangie. Beautiful stuff. And I've also noticed that when they are guesting spirits from other countries, from Tasmania or Japan or from Sweden or from India or from America, because it's the Scotch Malt Whisky Society and because of the extra kudos that people think it has, then the imported, the guest spirits can actually be seriously good casks. Look out for them, malt mates. What else can I add? Subscriptions jumped up, annual subscription, quite a bit now since I was a member. You get a box, a presentation box with a magazine and a little book and a few sample bottles in it. I got a standard bottle in mine, which was a few years ago now, but now you're looking at £122 a year to be a member if you're in the UK, and if you're out with the UK, it's over £200. It's £205 for your annual subscription to become a member of the Scotch Malt Whisky Society and get access to their bottlings. However, they do crop it up at auctions on a regular basis, and that's probably a good place to source them. Just saying, just sharing. How about this? phenolic fallout of a malt. It's a quite superb example of a very well-made, beautifully distilled, 8-year-old Port Charlotte, which is entirely 99% spirit-driven. The time in the cask over the 8 years has not allowed any oak influence to creep into this big phenolic bomb blast. It's basically the cask has been fighting just to kind of tame, control and round off the sheer exuberance of this hugely phenolic, volcanic phenol whiskey. Crisp, clean, appley, mint, loads of herbal, intense, bitter, sweet and sour, almost absinthe intense, phenolic, complex, clean, fresh, bright, fabulous, young, peated whiskey, which quite easily holds its own with any bottling of Lagavulin, Ardbeg, or Lafroig. What would I give this? Out of 100. What strength is it? You're going to love this. I've left the big bit to last. I have mentioned the word volcanic, did I not? What strength is this Port Charlotte? Let's have a look-see. Oh, it's 66.8% alcohol, 125 odd proof. My advice as a cynical old malt mate is do not hold naked flames anywhere near this single malt, because you might get your fingers burnt, or even worse, your tongue. Anyway, join me shortly. I'll be back again with another whiskey review. It'll be, I've no idea, I don't have a clue, I'm just not looking that far ahead now, but it'll be something quite tasty, juicy and well worth reviewing. Certainly something that scores over 80 out of 100. Maybe not as highly scored as this youthful Port Charlotte, but it'll be worth the effort. See you soon. Bye-bye.